Steve Trevelise. He's a Hall of Fame quarterback. He's one of America's best entrepreneurs, and he was my childhood idol growing up. I am giddy to be talking to Hall of Fame quarterback Fran Tarkenton. How are you?
I'm doing fine, Steve. And the Eagles finally got a win.
I don't care about the Eagles. I'm a Giants fan. Do you know what it's like being a Giant fan working in Philadelphia?
That's a hard deal, man.
Oh, my God. Fran, when you played, and I became a Giant fan in 1969, your first game, you beat the Minnesota Vikings where you came from. And you go on to have a 6-8 season. In 1970, you take the Giants to 9-5. You wrote a book called Broken Patterns with Brock Yates.
Yep.
I read Better Scramble Than Lose.
My goodness, you tell them all.
I read Broken Patterns. I can tell you your life story. I can't believe we're having this conversation.
How about that? Woof, boy.
Your helmet, your autographed helmet sits on my desk. But aside from all that, a couple of things I just want to get out of the way before we talk about the book.
Okay.
Some say, and I'm inclined to agree, that you invented the West Coast offense with the Giants in 1967.
Wasn't by myself, but we did. And I'll tell you how it came about. Y.A. Tittle, the great Giant quarterback, who before that was a 49er quarterback, lived in San Francisco. Y.A. would come and be at training camp with, wasn't a coach, just be there. He was always great. I loved to talk to Y.A. And he, Dick Nolan, who was assistant coach under Tom Landry, who was the head coach of coming in San Francisco, and he was going over stuff that Landry was doing, which was pretty revolutionary on the offensive side.
Right.
And so it was multiple formations, it's empty backfields, it's all this kind of stuff. And I looked at and Y.A. started drawing it out for me and said, Y.A., that's got to be our offense. And so we took that seed of that.
Right.
And we turned that into what was later called the West Coast offense. And, you know, we threw the ball to the tight ends and to the running backs in the short passing game and the quick rhythms because we didn't have many players in New York. I was taller than both offensive tackles, and so we could knock people off the ball. And so we started tearing up the league offensively at New York. And then when I went back to Minnesota, I hooked up with Jerry Burns, and we just took that West Coast offense to another level. And not only did I profit from it, but also every backup I ever had, whenever they went into play, they played great. And, Y.A. Tittle is really the guy that brought the ideas to me, and he and I developed them together, but it was the seeds of the West Coast offense.
I remember reading in Broken Patterns, it's a game, and I remember the game. It was Giants-Cowboys, it's 1970, you bring the team back. The last play of the game, you call the play, they're walking out of the huddle, you call them back, you change the play, and you hit Ron Johnson in the end zone for a crossing pattern, I think it was, and they win. Giants win 23-20. And I remember reading where you say, you know, it's amazing that one simple play, well executed, can beat a great defense like Dallas had in that year. And that's kind of like the philosophy that you apply to life. As I'm looking in your book here, you must fail in order to win. The power of failure.
Well, you know, life is not easy, as all your listeners know. We struggle. When we think things are going well, something hits us right in the face, and we have to get up and go again. And the one thing that I know, in order to be continued successful or have success, you've got to work at it every day. You've got to get smarter every day. You've got to do things. And if you do things, everything you're doing is not going to work. Most of the things I try don't work. And what you do things, you knock on more doors, you solve more problems, and then when they don't work, you own that disappointment, you own that failure, and you learn from that, and you move on. Jordan Spieth today, a big article with him in the New York Times about he didn't have his best game in the FedEx Cup playoffs last week when he won $11 million. And he went out, and he got there on Monday, and he and one other guy were the only two golfers on the course, and they were hitting balls and practicing and putting and chipping. And he was the greatest young golfer. I mean, he'd won more money this year, had a better year than any golfer in the history of the world, 22. But he talked about failure, failure, failure. No, the swing wasn't secure, and he had to go work, 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 and try, 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 which he's been doing for the last few weeks. That's what you have to do in life. And people in life that are struggling, they think, well, maybe good luck's going to happen. Maybe a silver bullet's going to happen. There are no silver bullets. But you have the power within yourself to go out and make things happen, but you got to go and do them and understand, own the failure. You're going to fail most of the time in trying to learn. And once you have some success, you got to continue trying and failing because success is not final. Does that make sense?
No, it makes total sense. And when I look at your football career, you were one of the first players, too, to invest your money to grow your brand, which is now a brand, you know. But what was then,
yep.
You know, you grew yourself so that when you got out of football, you were very well off as an entrepreneur, and you got into so many different things and computers and stuff.
Yeah.
But, I mean, like, when you played, it's you held every passing record when you retired, and yet you get remembered for losing 3 Super Bowls.
Yeah, you know, if you go back and look, everybody wants to know who's the greatest quarterback ever. And boy, Tom Brady and Peyton have made a good go for that, and Aaron Rodgers is too. But there's no answer to that. But if you go back and look at the players all the way back from Sammy Baugh and Sid Luckman, and these players held the records during their era for most touchdown passes and most yards gained passing, those 2 records.
Right.
And you look at in all the group that have owned those records over the years, then John Unitas, and then I broke John Unitas' records, and then Marino broke my record, and Favre broke Marino's, and Peyton is breaking those records. All those players were all great players because they produced at high levels. Now, let me brag for a minute, and I apologize for bragging.
Ah, go ahead.
But I held those records. My record stood up for 17 years.
Mm-hmm.
That's the longest run that anybody has ever had with their record holding out there. I broke John Unitas' record. He threw 400 touchdown passes. He threw 300 touchdown passes. I threw 342. He threw 40,000 yards. I threw for 47,003 yards. And those were huge numbers. My stuff, I'm still in the top 10 in all those categories, but now Peyton's going to throw for 70,000 yards by the time he finishes this season. But it's the production. You know, Dan Marino never won. He only played one Super Bowl, never won it. Jim Kelly lost 3. These were great, great players. Nobody's played the game better than Dan Marino or Kelly. And Y.A. Tittle never won a championship before they had Super Bowls. Mm-hmm. Nobody's played the game better than Y.A. Tittle. You've got to be in the right day, the right place, the right this. Everything's got to happen right to win that one game. You're known by what you do over your entire career, the quality of your play, and did you make your team better? And all the quarterbacks that produced, like I just mentioned, they made their team better.
And you made your team better because in a lot of times, including that 67 season, you were a one-man band. In 19, your first game, you throw 4 touchdown passes.
Yep.
You sent Marcus Mariota a letter.
I did.
When he did it. How about that?
Well, you know, it was interesting. I was drafted in the 3rd round, and that's a failure for a quarterback. If you look at failure, if you're a good, if they think you can play in the National Football League, and you play at a major school like I did at Georgia, they would draft you in the 1st round. 5 quarterbacks were drafted before me, and that's when we only had 12 teams. Tom Brady was drafted in the 6th round. He was drafted in the 6th round by Belichick, who didn't think he could play. His first year, he was on the taxi squad. He was the 4th quarterback. The next year, the quarterback gets hurt, and he plays, and there we go. And so you have all those things. I look back, and I had a chip on my shoulder.
You did.
And I came out, and I right off the bat, we beat the Bears 37-13. I threw for 4, ran for another one, and Mariota comes out, and he wasn't the first guy drafted. They drafted Jameis Winston, so they kicked him to the curb, said, this guy's going to be better than you, and he's got a chip on his shoulder, and he comes out and just torches the world that first game and throws for 4 touchdown passes, and they win the game, and he's played good the last 2 weeks. They're not a great team now, and so I just wanted to, you know, give him a little hello and give him a little recognition because he deserves it, because I think he's, you know, he's proven that he gets it. He's not going to have a great day every week, but at this age, first game, and you do what he did, that means you got a real chance to be something special.
Now, when you played with the Vikings, you were at odds with your coach, Norm Van Brocklin,
yep.
who was also a quarterback, and he didn't see eye to eye what you had to do to make that
Well,
team
he didn't
win.
See eye to eye. I mean, you know, he played, and you won a championship with Dutch there. He was a great, great quarterback.
Right.
But from the time he was in L.A. and he was splitting time with Bob Waterfield, he was controversial. He was a old grump. He was grumpy. And he comes to us after he wins the championship there. He's our coach. and he wasn't happy with anybody or anything. And when I go and win that first game, he and I started. He didn't like. He didn't like my play. He didn't like anybody getting recognition but himself. Mm-hmm. And so I stayed there for 6 years. I couldn't play for him anymore. Didn't have any respect for him, and so I forced the trade to New York. And I had, we didn't have any good players there at the time, any good teams. We had some players that were good, not a good enough teams. Organization was broken. Then I went back to Minnesota. And I was 31 before I really had a chance to compete. And now we came back with Bud Grant. We had a great coach. We had a great organization. And we went to 3 Super Bowls in 6 years. We won 6 straight division championships. And
you were phenomenal.
It was great.
If you indulge me, 2 questions. One, what was it like being a quarterback in New York with Joe Namath winning a Super Bowl? That'd drive you nuts.
Well, I love playing in New York. You know, when I went up there, the record in 66 was 112-1, and with a good quarterback, Earl Morrall was just a terrific quarterback. They traded 3 number ones and 2 number twos to get me there to come there and play. And the first year we were 500, maybe the best year I've ever had. We got the team, as you just mentioned, to 9-5. Playing in New York was great. It's my favorite city in the world. I go up about 4 times a year. I love the city. Great sports fan. All up in the Northeast, from Philadelphia to New York to Buffalo to New England. They're great, great sports fans of the Northeast. I loved every minute of playing. I just wish we had better teams.
What was the last game? I got to ask you this because I was there.
Yep.
You had never missed a game, and they bench you in the last game of the 71
season.
Well,
to their credit, they didn't bench me. I'd already made a deal with them that I talked to Wellington Mary, and I said, you need more players. You need to, you know, you could get something for me now. And so we had that agreement. Alex Webster was the coach, and he said, you know, do you mind if we start Randy Johnson, who was my backup? I said, you ought to start him, because it's the last game of the season. Do you want me to put you in for a play or something? I said, no, I don't want anything that artificial.
You were okay with that?
So I didn't. Yeah, I was fine with that.
Okay, now we go fast forward to 2000, and the Vikings are coming in for the NFC Championship game, and there's my hero, my idol, in a number 10 Minnesota jersey standing on the 50-yard line of the Meadowlands. What was up with that? What was up with that?
Well, that's where the Vikings played the Giants for the championship game.
I remember, yes.
Yeah, you know, I came back and I walked around and you know, the Giant fans were hissing and hooting and so forth, you know, because the Giant fans are Giant fans, and you know, I came back. I think I was guest of. In fact, I know I was guest of the Vikings because that was my team. But the Giants just annihilated the Vikings that day,
41-0.
Yeah, it was terrible.
We're talking with Fran Tarkenton, Hall of Fame quarterback, author of the book "The Power of Failure: Succeeding in the Age of Innovation." Best memories playing the Eagles, either with the Giants or the Vikings.
Well, you know, my best memory, one of my favorite players then and later, was Chuck Bednarik. Mm-hmm. And I became great friends with Chuck Bednarik. And he was the bomb. He was my hero. Played 60 minutes in that championship game against Green Bay. And in 1962, when I was a second-year player, we played Philadelphia in Bloomington, Minnesota. And I looked across the line, and the middle linebacker was number 60. So I remember that was his number, I think. Big old Chuck Bednarik was right there in front of me, and I looked over at him. I said, "Mr. Bednarik, it's a pleasure playing with you."
How about that?
Yeah, he and I became great friends. I could tell a lot of Chuck Bednarik, as everybody could. He was a great treasure, and thank God we had him for a long, long time, but I hate that he's gone.
He must have hated chasing you around, too. Now, to the book, the best advice anyone will take from reading this book, The Power of Failure.
Well, this book is for everybody because it's about success in life. It could be teachers or athletes or entrepreneurs because, you know, we're all trying to figure out how to get through the day productively, how to get better tomorrow. And I take my life of football and my life of business, real experiences, and make them very simple because I've learned from other people. Everything, none of us have an original thought. We have to learn from what we read, what we see, what we hear. And I put all these great stories in this book, and I validate failure. This is okay to fail. This is not losing. It's trying and failing. And I think when you get in there, you'll see the route to having success, the route to making your life more meaningful, the route to solving more problems. And that's what this book is about, and that's why I wrote it.
Fran, I can't thank you enough. I can't thank you enough for coming on. The book is great, The Power of Failure, Succeeding in the Age of Innovation.